Hello, how are you?
Hello, I'm great. How are you?
Abdulrahman, have I met you before?
Very briefly, sir. It was extremely abrupt.
It kind of entrepreneurial interaction, you know. But, well, it's nice to see you again. I've been to KAUST many times, and
yeah.
Hey, is the who are the people running KAUST? Is it still the Scottish fellow?
I don't know if he'll take offense to that. No, it was, I think you're referring to Gordon McConnell. No, it's Hatan Ahmed is the head of the Entrepreneurship Center right now.
Hatan. Yeah, I know Hatan. I was just, because there's somebody else. Let me just.
I think are you thinking maybe of Kevin Collins, who's the vice president of economic development? So that might be the Scottish fellow in mind. Scottish / Australian.
No, he's Scottish. And great guy. The person who runs KAUST now, I believe, came from Hong Kong, right?
Yes, Tony.
Yeah, he's great.
Yeah.
Awesome. We'll get started.
Exactly. So
thank
this
you.
Is like
so
the opening.
So great to actually see you. And hopefully we'll get to travel at some point soon. And we'll see you in person. Yes, all of us. Wait.
Kevin Cullen. Kevin Cullen
yes.
is the person.
Yeah, yeah. He's the vice president of innovation and economic development.
Oh, great. Yeah. So I've talked to Kevin. I've talked to the head of the university. He's a real mover and a shaker.
Mm-hmm.
He came and visited us. He's a character.
He's incredible. He cares deeply about it.
You should text Kevin now and ask him to join the call, Abdulrahman.
Yeah, actually, that's a good point.
Tell him that I'm asking for him.
Do that. Just open the phone and like, yeah.
See that, Amal? See what I just pulled out of my pocket?
I see. Oh.
Isn't that nice?
That is beautiful.
That makes me very happy.
Oh, that's really nice. It's when I came to your office, Bill, at the center, you had a lot of beautiful stuff in your office. I can see you've got so many of these beautiful stuff from a lot of people. So, You had products, you had, messages from people. So that's really great. I think you keep it always, very personal.
That's my artwork, Amal.
Of course. I mean, you have a very artistic space. Well.
No, I don't know anything about art.
Well, that's why it's art. When you don't know much about it, right?
Art is in the eye of the beholder.
Exactly. So we're just going to kick this off until Abdulrahman calls Kevin to the call. Maybe we can have his image and his voice, you know, for an intervention. So I want to thank you again for actually accepting this invitation in these times. And Bill Aulet is the Managing Director of the Martin Stress Center for MIT Entrepreneurship. He's Professor of Practice, MIT Sloan of Management. And I had the pleasure of being his student for a period of time. I hope I was a good one. See, I had the certificate up there from MIT REAP. So
and I was your student.
Oh, that's never the case. You know, it was fun days. And I used to tell them, I was telling Abdulrahman, Bell used to play music in the class, you know, and just to cheer us and the teams in REAP, you know, and get everyone excited to get in to start the day. But we're really thankful to have you here. We know you've got a lot to do, actually, and want to thank KAUST and actually for being with us, for organizing this, and for shaking hands with us at Global Entrepreneurship Network here in Saudi. So today, actually, in today's world, very interesting world, we're meeting you now on a webinar, and that's what the whole world is doing today. You know, they're spending their times in front of PCs, laptops, and connecting maybe more than ever, which is very, very, very strange at these times. So I think we'll just kick off, you know, our discussion for today, pointing at, you know, a fragile world, maybe, and what you have been building in that anti-fragile sense. So, Abdulrahman, any point?
So, just an FYI, Kevin has said that he's actually in the call.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so, hold on, let's see if I can find him. There's almost 99 people attending now.
He can't raise his hand. Kevin.
Kevin and Hatan, hello. Salam alaikum. There we go. I see Kevin. Oh, yes. I actually don't see him. I just see his name.
Yeah. Hello.
Hello, Kevin. How are you?
I'm very well. Thank you, Bill.
How is the battle going against non-entrepreneurship?
We fight the good fight.
And we're winning.
How are you, Kevin? Thank you for being here.
I'm very well, Amal. Good to see you all.
Very good. Great to see you,
Kevin.
Great to see you all. So we're going to have the Q&A, as Amal said, so please try to post your questions early. People tend to post the questions really late, and they're hesitating, and then we don't get to them on time. So entrepreneurs, act quick, act decisively. So please try to get those in really, really quick. So, you know, I think you're known for a lot of things, Bill, whether it's basketball or, you know, the three startups or the MIT work. But, you know, a lot of what still rings true is the book, Discipline Entrepreneurship. Can you just give a high level to people as to what caused you to write the book way back in 2012? What was the driver? You know, you're not what most people would call an academic. So something must have driven you to that angle. And, you know, writing a book is not a forgiving process. What was the why?
A funny story about that. A friend of mine from college, Chris Field, called up. And after I'd written this book and it come out, and he called me up and he said, Bill, you've written a book? And I said, yes, Chris, I wrote a book. He goes, that means you've written one more book than you read in college. Which I beg to differ with him on that.
But, that's great motivational talk, yeah.
But it's really pretty simple. I worked at IBM for 11 years. I went to MIT, and when I was at MIT, I took the classes on entrepreneurship, and then I came out and I wanted to start a company badly. So I started this company called Cambridge Decision Dynamics, and it was a glorious failure. Glorious because I learned so much, but it still was a failure. And anyone that says embrace failure is crazy. Failure sucks. It's terrible. You don't want to fail. You want to do everything you can. And so what I went to the second one, which is Sensible, and that was much, much more successful, which is easy if the first one's negative. And then the third one was very successful, called Visage. And I thought, why didn't people teach that to me when I was at MIT? And so MIT asked me to teach, and you're correct, Abdulrahman. I am an accidental academic. I'm an entrepreneur by design for life. And so I'm teaching this class, and I go out to try to find a textbook, and there's no textbooks. There's a good book here on crossing the chasm. There's a good book here on blue ocean strategy. There's a good book here on, you know, lean startup. There's a good book here on design thinking. But nothing kind of pulled it together in an integrated, simple way. And, you know, we can't give entrepreneurs like the user manual for a Boeing 747. Entrepreneurs want stuff that's quick. And so I put this thing together as a reader for my class at MIT. And you notice that there's illustrations. And as Amal said, sometimes we use music in our class, and sometimes we do improv. That's what entrepreneurs want. They want to have fun while they do it. They want to be engaged. And so that's why I did Disciplined Entrepreneurship. And really what it is just the best of all the things that I could find and brought them together and stitched them together in a common language.
Do you think, Bell, today with all the changes and what the world is going through, and now we're hearing everybody saying the world will not be the same again, there will be a lot of differences and things are going to change, and there is the other optimistic view, we'll go back to life, but there will be slight awakening, you know, kind of on what used to happen and how do we change it. So does the rules really still apply? I mean, do we really follow everything that we have been teaching, everything that we know about entrepreneurship, you know, or are things are going to be really different, and how different are they?
Yeah, so I just did a talk this week, which I don't know if you had a chance to hear, but I was talking about this, and I said, you know, in computing, there have been two fundamental laws that have driven it. Moore's law, which says that the power of the computer comes down, doubles every 18 months, and Metcalfe's law, which says the value of the network increases exponentially as the value of the number of nodes on it. Both those laws have not only driven it, but they set in people's mind as to, oh, that's what's happening. I think we need a new law right now, and I'm calling it a Siegel-Trudeau law, after Sue Siegel was the chief innovation officer at General Electric, and Pierre Trudeau, who's the prime minister of Canada. And basically what they say is that the world will never be as slow as it is today. The world is only going to get faster and faster. You know, when Sue Siegel said this for the first time at MIT a year ago, people were like, oh my God, it can't get any more crazy. I mean, we have Trump as president, Brexit just happened. Well, oh my God, if we could only go back to those days right now, we would be so happy. But yeah. It's COVID-19. It will be something else tomorrow. It will be something else after that. It will be something. And these things are happening faster and faster. And the magnitude of them is getting bigger and bigger. So in answer to your question, do these principles apply? They apply more than ever before, because what you're taught in business school is how to manage. And what is management? Management is about optimizing an existing system. Management is about making it more predictable. Management is about de-risking that system. And that's not what we're talking about now. We're talking about, when you do that, by the way, you make a fragile system that when it gets hit by an exogenous force or an external force, it will break. And so management, I'm not saying that management isn't important. What I'm saying is that entrepreneurship, creating new systems, being anti-fragile, thriving, not surviving, thriving in times of rapid change is exactly what we need now. And the fundamental principles that we're teaching in entrepreneurship that you're doing so well at KAUST, of mindset, of skill set, of way of operating, that's the future. And right now, I'll just say at MIT, our center, we work really hard, but we have never worked harder than we are right now, because if anything proves our worth, it's this crisis to show other people don't know what to do. We're producing anti-fragile speakers doing. We're doing a hackathon that involves 90 plus companies. We just came up with a new, we didn't. We work with other people in an entrepreneurial way to help them come up with a new shield to protect the frontline workers. We declare that we're gonna have a weekly anti-fragile hero. Our systems that we had to allow people to social distance have all changed. Oh, by the way, because our center was the place that everybody came for physical interaction, that doesn't work anymore. So we quickly came up with virtual coffee shops, town meetings on Zoom, and all this kind of stuff. So my response to your question is, does it still apply? The answer is, it applies more than ever before. The world needs what we're doing more than ever before.
So that's the thing. It's you no longer probably need to convince. You know, when you say these problem solving, critical thinking, entrepreneurship inside corporations, startups, design thinking, all of that, this is exactly what these times actually need. And that's why we probably see that startups are thriving more than ever. And maybe even in Saudi and in the region, we're seeing that when things fell down, startups are the ones who started the deliveries. The startups are the one that became more resilient than ever, you know, tweaking and fixing their models and all of that, and really serving their customers in the best way that they could. So I think that's a message that we're conveying maybe to corporations, to startups, to individuals in many ways.
Absolutely. And I've even heard that from people, deans and high-level people, MIT, they're saying, wow, we need people acting like what you're acting like right now. And they're seeing that, you know, clock speed, all these things that we talk about, moving fast, you know, milestones, all that is what's going to get us out of this crisis. And not only get us to the other side, when we get to the other side, we're going to be stronger for it. And we're going to be ready for the next COVID-20 or whatever it is.
God forbids.
Yeah. The next black swan, right?
Let me say God forbid, but it will happen. You do understand that there will be another pandemic, and there will be one that is going to be worse than it. And I don't wish that. Don't get me wrong. I do not wish that at all.
Absolutely.
But there will be. And there will be geopolitical problems, and there will be climate change problems, and there will be storms. And by the way, they'll start happening at the same time. Imagine if we had Katrina right now while we have COVID-19. I don't wish it, but it will happen. That's Siegel/Trudeau's law. And people need to start getting that in their mind, that we are never going back to the way it was. We're never going back to horse and buggies. We're never going back to abacus. That world of that's slow, it's only going to get faster. And we need to learn to embrace this change. And that's what entrepreneurs do. We say, we didn't want that, but next play. That window closed, what window is opening? Let's get there and let's figure out what the opportunity is.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's ironic that we launched the resilience series with somebody talking about fragility and anti-fragility. Could you give people a sense? I think it's people look at Nassim Taleb's work now with fresh eyes, with a new perspective on, you know, black swans and anti-fragility in general. Could you explain what anti-fragility is and how that's different than resilience and robustness?
Yeah. So fragile is a negative condition. If something happens, you don't want, you know, adversity, and unexpected, you break. Robustness means I am going to just keep going forward. I'm just going to keep going forward. All this stuff's happening. It bounces off me like rain off a duck, like bullets off a tank. And I'm just going to keep going straight ahead. Anti-fragility means something just happened. Let's talk about that and let's figure out what we can do to get better out of this. How do we take the changes and get stronger out of this? And so to me, fragility is the negative condition. Robustness, resilience is the neutral condition. Anti-fragility is the positive state. And that's how I see the difference. And again, it goes back to all we talk about in entrepreneurship. It's a mindset. Something went wrong. Well, we didn't want that to happen, but that creates more opportunities. Where are those opportunities? How do we get to those opportunities? How do we fix that? And that's, so it's the mindset, it's the skill set, and it's the way of operating, which is a community-based. To me, entrepreneurship is three things. It's first, you have to have the mindset. Second of all, it's a skill set. How do you affect new changes? But the third thing is, it's a community-based way of working. It's, I don't have to control everything. I will build a community of people who I have trust with, and then we will essentially barter our services to each other and will help each other to be successful. And this community-based model is the way of the future to be more anti-fragile as an individual, as a team, as an organization, as a society. When I was at IBM, we had to control all the resources. Mm-hmm. And that is an inefficient, fragile model, just to be clear. I feel like I'm an American preacher here.
Hey, you said it. Yeah, you know, startups have to be cults, right?
Good cult.
Pirates.
Exactly. Rogues and rebels. Rebels without a cause.
Rebels with a cause. And that's one big thing that I think is coming through. I don't know if your people have had a chance to see our anti-fragile series, and it was really good. One of the things is, if you think a crisis is an opportunity to be a profiteer, to just make some money, you will not last. And people will call you out now for that. You have to have, we are doing this for a purpose. This is principled entrepreneurship, as we talk about in our series. And that's not just because we're good moral people. I hope we are. But it's also because that's good business. Because people today won't stay with you just for money. They want to know that you're doing something in this crazy, crazy world that will make us better, that will bring out the best in us, that will make society better. And so if you just do it for the money, they'll stay with you on the way up. But there's never been an entrepreneurial venture that's just gone straight up. It goes up and then it goes down. And if they're with you with the money on the way up, they'll stay with you. When it goes down, they'll jump to work at Goldman Sachs or someplace where they can make more money. And that's exactly when you need your people committed, is when you're hitting the tough times. Mm-hmm. So I think one of the big changes that's going to come out of this is purpose, more purposeful, more principled entrepreneurship. And I think that's a very good thing.
I mean, so startups tend to be the poster child of anti-fragility in the business world, right? You know, they experiment, they validate, they get better, they get deeper insights, and their product improves over time the more challenges they face. And it's just about encouraging them to face those stressors early. But, you know, even Nassim Taleb mentions, you know, startups in his book as an example. But the irony is, you know, as startups find product market fit, they then mobilize resources to inject more process, to start being more efficient, to start evolving away from fragility. How is it, like, is that an inevitability, or is there some way that you always maintain that state?
No, it's a natural evolution. So what makes you anti-fragile is you have to be anti-fragile. Like when I grew up, I just had no choice. It wasn't like my mommy and daddy had lots of money and I could just kind of coast. I had to fight and I had to figure out. And if I sat down and said, oh, you know, woes to me, people aren't being nice to me, I got nowhere. And so necessity makes you anti-fragile. And then all of a sudden, if you get to be to a place where you're comfortable, where you have assets, like you're talking about doing, it's harder to be anti-fragile. You know, the old saying, hungry dog hunts best. So the question that you have is really the essence of the corporate entrepreneurship question. And this is that an oxymoron? Mm-hmm. Is it, once you become a big corporation, can you continue to be entrepreneurial? And the fact is, it's not easy, but it is possible, and we must do it. We must do that. There are only so many things that can be done by venture-backed startups that they'll get the low-hanging fruit. But if you want to change the energy industry, you think as a startup that you can create a grid, a trillion-dollar grid? No way. Can you recreate the pipelines? You know, no. If you're in healthcare or if you're in other industries, so to get this higher fruit, which is important for our society, we need to have corporate entrepreneurs. And corporations know that because they want that, you know, they look at it, you know, look, the shelf life, the length of time that someone's on the Fortune 500 now has decreased by 50 years since 1917. General Electric just came off the S&P 500. I mean, it's crazy. But corporations know, just like species, that it's not the strongest that survives. It's not the most intelligent that survives. It's the one that adapts the fastest. That's Charles Darwin in Species. But you see it applies to companies as well. And this is, and they're trying to understand, how do they become more entrepreneurial? And this is something that we're spending a lot of time looking at this at MIT. Elaine Chen spearheaded that. We have a course in corporate entrepreneurship. We did it with Sue Siegel, who I mentioned from General Electric. And it is one big area of focus for the future. I know Saudi Aramco very, very much wants to have entrepreneurial people in their organization. That doesn't mean all the people are entrepreneurial. there's a group of people who are going to manage the Gowar Reservoir, and they should be very conservative about it. They should manage that carefully. But you often have to think about the next big thing, the over the horizon. I'm sorry, I'm giving you long answers. How can we only have 9 questions here? What's going on?
Really, are these people? Well, people are excited, and you've got some Aramco people here that are actually listening to you. So that's a good thing, right?
So absolutely.
That's Sarah here, and she's sending her regards. But in general, I think what you're talking about is the essence of really how do we live in that world, you know, and become more, you know, resilient and flexible with all what's happening and be focused at the same time. But yes. That brings also to the point of, you know, the existing structure of whether it's corporations, the existing mindset of a startup and how they started and they put the strategies and their team and all of that. And what is the role really of the people inside in leading that change and bringing it to the place, you know, where they are today? As you mentioned, the struggle is the one with the mindset, right? And you said we have to be focused on purpose, on all of these stuff that will make us relevant today. With all of that, really, what are the skills that are needed within the people? You know, is it about leadership? Is it about management? Is it about organization? What is it that will take us from the old way of thinking to the new place that we want to be in?
Yeah, I think it's this whole anti-fragile kind of direction. I'm sorry to keep repeating myself. It was funny, we had a staff meeting the other day, and we went and it was 18 minutes in, and I finally said anti-fragile something, and someone said, see, it took them 18 minutes to say anti-fragile. But if we learn anything from the COVID crisis, we have to have this mentality of anti-fragility. We have to not embrace adversity, but we have to look at adversity as part of the learning process, you know. And I think it comes down to this kind of mindset that where KAUST is really the tip of the spear, I believe, in the society, in this KSA, is how do you get people to understand that adversity is a good thing? That's what makes you stronger. How do you get to understand that, as I always say in basketball, if you make every shot, you're not shooting enough. You can't be innovative if everything goes right. You're only innovative if something has gone wrong. Now, that doesn't mean you seek to have things go wrong, but you keep pushing until you find where the boundary condition is, how far you can go. So it's this, of course you need conservative mindset for some things. As I mentioned, if you've got the Gowar Reservoir, you better not be just fast failing on that. You manage that carefully, but you have to have areas where you embrace kind of new thinking and pushing the envelope. So to me, that's, we need to re-index in our educational institutions and society, not to get rid of management, but index more towards the entrepreneurial skill set, mindset, and way of doing business. And that's what we're gonna do. And it has been, look, this comes down to human capital. It does not come down to economic results. I know everybody always wants economic results, but economic results are follow when you have human capital. And so really universities like KAUST and the HR department and the leadership at Saudi Aramco have to do that. And I know they did. That's why Saudi Aramco has been such a great company. When I look back to Juma and Khaled Al-Fala, they were very committed to developing the human capital of the corporation. And this ability to think long-term is how you solve these problems. Short-term thinking is not going to get you there. Now, again, I don't want to get anyone to say, oh, we have no need for management. We do need management. It's a balance between the two.
Well, that's the thing. It's the message of the development of the human capital. Again, you know, it's equipping them with the tools and the skills that are needed, because it's not impossible. It's about what we got used to and where do we want to get. And maybe today's times, you know, it's pushing them to do that by force. It's no longer a choice, as everybody's saying. Everyone realizes that now we're all working this way, and who would have thought that any government offices or corporations will just be able to operate while people are still at home, right? And they'll be able to do all of that. So I think there is a lot of signals that are giving people the right hints, and it's no longer hints, it's what they have to do really in order to survive.
Yes. And by the way, I just want to be clear, I am very optimistic about this. I think that change and getting people out of their comfort zone and creative destruction is very, very good. We can't hold on to the horse and buggies. We've moved on from that, right? You can't go back to that. I think people who think that retail places are just, you know, going to come back and you can work offline, that's not going to be the case. You're going to have to be we're not going to wipe out offline, but you have to combine that with online. And you've seen the companies that have been able to do that. The world's going to be more digital going forward rather than less digital. That doesn't mean there's no room for the physical. That means there's no room for the offline, but it has to be coupled with the online. If you're not in e-commerce and you're strictly a retail shop sitting there trying to do that, you're holding on to the horse and buggy waiting for the world to come back after the car has been invented.
Absolutely.
So I mean,
shout out to the Jamil group, by the way, speaking of cars.
I mean, you talk a lot about mindset and, you know, the operating system that kind of drives the person. You know, in these times, everybody's inundated with all these predictions, all these different information sources contradicting theses on how the world will pan out. Like, how do you separate clarity? How do you separate fact from fiction in these kind of times?
So let me say twofold. First of all, you need to look at facts. You need to have extensive sense-making capabilities and be scientific about how you analyze it. You can't just go on gut feel. So it's very important that you're looking for facts, you're looking for evidence. This is called sense-making, and you're getting diverse opinions on that. But let me just go to the second point of it, is we had co-founder of Netflix, Mark Randolph, come to MIT. He's someone I've known for a long time, and he was a co-founder and first CEO of Netflix, and he has a book that I recommend everybody called That Will Never Work. And the fundamental premise I got from Mark was, nobody knows anything. Nobody knows anything. And the title of the book's called That Will Never Work. And it comes from the story, like he said, to his wife, I'm going to do this thing. And he explained to her Netflix, and she said, that will never work. And you think that then the next line is, I showed her that it would work. And he said, she was right. It would never have worked the way we had initially envisioned it. And we had to test things time and time again. And so you have to kind of get general directions, but know that all it is a hypothesis that needs to be tested. And you need to learn how to do, you have to learn how to do small tests very, very quickly in a direction, but assume that it is just a guess as to where things are going. So predictions, they're just guesses. What you really need to know is how to do quick hypothesis testing to go in that direction. I see you shaking your head, Amal.
Well, I love what you're saying, because, you know, these are the things that we want. When you talk about testing, you know, it's funny that all of the entrepreneurs that we spoke to in the past period, we've been running these Arabic webinars, they all said, we had plans that we've been delaying. When COVID-19 came, and those are all digital, we rolled out our actually products or services and we tested them and they worked. So the pandemic came and created that pressure for people to run these tests that they have been hypothesizing about for a very long time, you know, and now it's time to just bring it out, right? But how do we really push for those quick, really hypotheses and rollout testing? You know, I think there's, you know, something here to be said about that.
Yeah.
You know, that's where the problem is.
And I think that's really important. It's not just that nobody knows anything and you should make a bet on something. Fiascos. I was listening to this great podcast yesterday. It's called This American Life. And they're talking about fiascos. What makes just, you know, epic failures. And what happens in epic failures is somebody thinks they know what's going to happen and they place a huge bet on it without doing small tests before they get there. And this is the same thing when you listen to our anti-fragile speaker series. Jocko Willink, the number one New York Times bestseller, talks about when he trains Navy SEALs. He said, you got to look at a situation, you got to evaluate it, and then you got to understand, all right, which way do I think is the answer? And then you take small steps. And if the first one works, then you go more, then you go more, then you go more. But you don't put huge bets on things. And that's where people, you know, I get frustrated when people say, oh, Steve Jobs did this. You know, Mark Zuckerberg did this. Entrepreneurship by watching Hollywood will lead you so far astray. Forget all that stuff. You know, go to the basics of entrepreneurship. And we know what are the first principles that work. They don't guarantee you success. They just dramatically increase your odds. And if you watch kind of, you know, Steve Jobs, the movie, or Social Network, you're getting the wrong impression of what entrepreneurship is. It's not Hollywood.
Absolutely. And it's crazier, huh? So I think what's interesting that to the next point, you know, I'm going to pull up that question because it kind of relates to the next point, that a lot of the startups today are actually coming up with those reactive, if I may say, kind of solutions, you know, to stay alive, generate funding, to have a little bit of runway, you know, until things go back to semi-normal or whatever the situation is over. Now, what is the advice that we need to give to those? Some of these products and services will minimize. Some of it may flourish, like what we've heard in some of the companies, that actually the solutions that they came up with today are much operating in a much better way than the old ones. Here, what is the advice that we give to these entrepreneurs in order to have a more, you know, of a vision to the future and how to really react? You know, is this the right approach today?
So I would say two things. First of all, I will never fault an entrepreneur for doing what they need to stay alive. Like, you must, the number one job, we tell this to our students in our classes, the number one job of the CEO of a startup company is to not run out of cash. And sometimes there are things you do to not run out of cash. But if you run out of cash, the body runs out of oxygen, it dies. A business runs out of cash, it dies. So I will never sit there and talk about strategy with an entrepreneur who has to get oxygen to survive. Now, that being said, let me go to the second point. And this kind of goes to your question, Abdulrahman, about the difference between anti-fragility and resilience or robustness. Is we see three types of entrepreneurs today, you know, what's happening with this crisis at MIT. And it's so crystal clear. Some people get the input, they see COVID-19 and they go, oh my God, let me look at all this stuff that's coming in. And the fundamental business that I had, the hypotheses are so negated that right now I have to take my hands and I have to fold. I have to just say, this is not going to work. And this idea that entrepreneurs never give up, they give up on ideas. They don't give up on themselves. But sometimes, just like if you're playing cards, you take a hand and you put it down. You say, I'm out on this round. I'll be back next round, but I'm out on this round. But that's the first one. The second group of people say, here's my plan. I'm raising money. I don't care whether it's COVID-19 or not. I'm just going straight forward. And they ignore what's going on. They ignore what's going on. And then the third group says, you know, COVID-19, is that my business? If I make these adaptations, not only will we survive this, when we get to the other side, we will thrive. So they take the input, they modify it, and they come out the other side. The worst of these three is the middle one I just described. And this goes to the point, Abdulrahman. They are ignoring the changes that's going on. They're just like bulldozing straight ahead. It is a very reasonable thing to look at new data and say, I'm folding. It's the other one is, I look at this new stuff and saying, hey, I need to adjust our plan to do this. Those are good. This one, not good. And so that's the advice we're giving to people. Do not ignore what's going on. Nobody can tell you with a crystal ball what's going to be on the other side here in 45 days, but we have some good ideas here. The world's going to be more digital. You know, geographic things are going to matter less than they did. Look at this. We're sitting here talking, you know, here, and we have 130 people throughout all of Saudi Arabia. Maybe there's even someone here from Ohio. You know, we're not doing that 45 days ago. We weren't doing that 60 days. We weren't doing our anti-fragile speaker series. As I said, we just had a virtual hackathon where we had 4,500 applicants from 90 plus countries working on how to solve COVID. There's some really good things that come out of this, and we need to embrace those. And the big, you know, when you think about this, the hardest, the most difficult thing for an entrepreneur is not cash. The most difficult thing for an entrepreneur is to break, is to get a good team. But once you have a good team, you then have to break habits of people, break habits of organizations, break habits of society. And that's very difficult, except if there's a crisis, because when there's a crisis, that's what's called a window of opportunity, and people will change their habits. And that's what we're in right now, a window of opportunity. And people are going to change their habits, and you have to figure out what are those, and then what new opportunities does that present, and then what are we going to do about that?
Absolutely. Do you have any examples? I'm going to put you under the spot here. Any examples of interesting companies that came up with something, changed their model, you know, at these times? Like, is there anything that comes to your head at this point?
Well, yeah. So we have a whole bunch of them. That's like asking me about my grandchildren, Amal. Yeah. I could talk all day about that. But since you asked, how much time do we have? 2:11. So let me just give you a few examples. So we have this company with two female entrepreneurs, Mariana Matas from Mexico and Nusha Gailey, who's from Canada. And they started a company called Biobot Analytics. And what they do is she's a biological engineer and an urban planner. And they're really hustlers. They went through our Delta V program. They've gone through the full circuit of disciplined entrepreneurship stuff. So what they do is they take something and they put it in the sewer system. Excuse me, this is gonna be pretty authentic. And they put it in there. And so what they do is they analyze what people flush in their toilets and what they every day. And what you get out of that is incredibly valuable information about people's biological markers. And so they were trying to convince people to do this, and they couldn't get people to do this. Just to put this in perspective, if I had this system and I was in Boston and we put it around, we could tell you how many people were doing heroin, how many people were doing fentanyl, how many people had the Zika virus, etc. And we could tell you the neighborhoods that they were in. This system, they were struggling to get going. And then what they started to get going with was the opioid crisis, because that was a critical problem that was drawing attention and getting money put to it. They were doing the opioid crisis and they started to get traction. Great governors like Charlie Baker started saying, hey, we need to have this thing in, because then we can get data ahead of. You don't want to just know how many people died of opioids in your state. They want to know what's it look like? What's coming at us? This is, you know, the way we've been doing it is how many people died. That's like judging in the rearview mirror what's going on. So they did this, and they were starting to kind of roll out slowly with this opioid crisis, but they were getting traction. Now COVID-19 comes along. If this system had been installed, they could have told you where COVID-19 was coming from, and we could have taken the tests that we had and we could have focused on those areas. And they have started to do so. They've gone from student body left and opioid. We can do that. We'll be back there later. Student body right, COVID-19. And they have already shown, if you look it up, Biobot Labs, Biobot Analytics, they have showed that the statistics that people believe, because all they can do is test and there aren't enough tests, they're lower by at least one order of magnitude. That's 10 times lower, and it might be two orders of magnitude lower. They might be off by 1,000 times. 100 times lower. So that's mind blowing. And so for them, they kind of took the student body right. I can give you other ones that just, let me give you one that I think is a really good one. One of them is another one who's, this is one of my sons, so I have to disclose it, and his two colleagues. They started a company in-home exercise called Ergatta. And so what they do is they basically came up with a new way where you could have a rowing machine in your house. So Peloton's very popular, but it's for a certain demographic, psychographic, and it's your legs. There's another demographic, psychographic, that doesn't want to do classes. They want to get a good workout. They want to work out their full body. And when this happened, they didn't quite know what they had, but then all of a sudden their sales take off. And that's an example of kind of reading it right. Let me tell you someone who was in the wrong place in this, an entrepreneur, and how they adjusted. And this is a former student, great, terrific guy, Sal Lapoli. He has Sal's Pizza in Boston. And he's the biggest pizza, I think, by far in Boston. And he has a real estate. And the food restaurant business just craters.
Yeah.
And pizza's holding on a little bit for takeout. And so what a lot of people do is they start closing their business. Well, Sal has built up a pretty big business. He's employing tens of thousands of people now, and at least thousands of people. I think he's employing over 10,000. And he has to make a decision. Does he start laying people off? And he goes and he thinks about this, and being a principled entrepreneur, he says, I can't do that. What do these people have? If I do that, they're going to be unemployed. They won't have anything. So what he does is he cuts the price of his pizza in half. As opposed to $10 a pizza, it's $5 a pizza. And he says, I said, why did you do that, Sal? Why are you doing that in other people? He said, because I got to keep these people employed, because my customers now, a lot of them aren't, their jobs are going away. They have less money. The people are at home. It's a stressful situation. What I can do is I can give them two meals for the price that they used to have of one. I said, but you're losing money. He said, yeah, I'm losing money. But you know what, Bill? In the long term, when we get to the other side of this, I will have kept my employees. I will have kept my customers. And they will be more loyal to me and the other side than they even were today. And that's just what I have to do. That's just what I have to do. If I put these people out, what are they going to do? They got nothing. If I take my customers and I keep the same price and their income's gone down. So right now, I'm going to take the hit. When we get to the other side, we'll sort it out. But that's what I have to do as a principled entrepreneur. Sorry, you asked the question.
No, we got three examples. That was wonderful. Different sectors and different, different dynamics for each one. Perhaps we can touch on some of the audience questions. Given that the clock is ticking. So we have Ibrahim and Anizi. He's asking, what industries do you expect entrepreneurs, investors to run away from after the pandemic has ended? That's pretty interesting. Not during, but after the pandemic.
Well, they're already running away. If you're in the cruise, if you're in the cruise line industry, it's not been a good few months. If you're in the restaurant industry, that's been really difficult. If you're totally committed to an offline business, you have a world of hurt. So the ones who are going to do well are the ones who have digital capability. That's where it will be. But I think you're going to see across the board opportunities. That there's not going to be just one place. I'll tell you, one of them that's going to be a very hard hit is the education. This is going to be a really, how did we go from doing very little online courses to doing all virtual classes? And it still works. And so when we go back, it will be virtual. So I think you're going to see, the good news is everything's going to be scrambled up and there are going to be lots of opportunities. Anyone who's holding on to the past to think it's just going to be the same, I would run away from those.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't seen people run away from, paper currency is quite as fast. I never expected that transition to happen as quickly as we've seen just in the past few months. It's remarkable. I mean, so we have one other question from Haytham Al-Humsi. Can we talk about the categories of opportunities? One category, working on crisis opportunity directly. Another, working on solving problems related to secondary effects. And others, working on problems that might be dependent on the macro situation. And I think it's also related to another question from Sean Flanagan, who's saying, traditionally, we look at for success in disruptive technologies, but the entire economy has been disrupted. How do we help entrepreneurs look for opportunities beyond the cause of this disruption? We can't all be making masks, for example. So two about the different kinds of opportunities that are available that were kind of teased in your examples that you mentioned.
Yeah. So we in the anti-fragile speaker series, we had the principal analyst from Forrester Research, the premier research company, talk about opportunities on the other side. And he said something really interesting. He said, you know, and it reinforced another point that came from this that this person I teach with at MIT. I like to call him a colleague, but he won a Nobel Prize and I've won nothing. His name's Bengt Holmstrom. And he said, disruptive technological innovation is overrated in face of imitation. And this became really clear as well. I just want to reinforce this point with James McQuivey from Forrester. He said, innovation isn't a switch. It isn't like we just turn a switch and it happens. It's dials, and we dial it up slower or faster. And so the answers for what's going to be on the other side are almost 99% or more already here. We just have to figure out how we utilize them and evolve them and enhance them. Zoom was always out there. Slack was always out there. We just didn't use it well enough before. And then as we started to use it, it became. So the idea of some new switch that we found, you know, in some closet that we didn't know before, that's not it. It's already out here someplace. And we just have to figure out how do we, again, slowly increase it to see if it works and increase it more and more and more over time.
Well, there's a lot of questions, you know, that are coming, but I think as Abdulrahman said, some are related. There's a question that you just mentioned, the pizza, which is, you know, do you think the way business is done, restaurants, et cetera, will change for good and a new way will prevail, basically? So, yeah, I mean, if we take the retail, you know, or the restaurants industries in particular, food, so how would that look like really with all of the changes?
So first of all, I don't know. Nobody knows anything.
Yeah. We know you don't know for 100%.
So anyone who has a perfect crystal, since they have a perfect crystal ball, is lying. And so all that seems clear to me is that, again, in the dials of online versus offline, you better be ready to turn up your online and dial back your offline. Whether people are going to be in close proximity with each other again, you know, Andrew, the Dr. Fauci has said, people shaking hands, we should never do that anymore. I don't know whether that's true or not, but people are going to be a little more thinking harder about going to restaurants and sitting so close to people. But are they going to be willing to order out and have things and have them brought to them? I think they will. But time will tell.
Well, I read an interesting article today, and it was talking about how the cinemas are getting ready for after the pandemic and how they're redividing, that there is no way that people will sit next to each other the way they used to. So now they're looking whether to remove the seat, you know, one there and the other one is removed so they can leave more of a room, like half a meter, or they're going to block them for the time being. And it was reflecting on multiple industries how the social distance will play a role that we've never seen. And I think in societies like in the Middle East in particular, this is going to be a very, you know, interesting thing to watch how people will be able to adopt into social distancing, knowing that people here are accustomed to, you know, hugging and like, clothes and like all of that, you know, when they see each other in the street. So I think that would be interesting in terms of customer behavior, you know, and how people struggle really with that, you know, now afterwards as well.
But that is absolutely true, and nobody knows for sure. I mean, I think of you guys, I also think of Italy. Think of Italy, my God. Yeah. No one goes anywhere without kissing other people, right? but here's the even bigger issue, Amal. Geography I think it's very clear, geography is not going to matter as much when we get to the other side of this. Guess what? Boise, Idaho is looking a lot more interesting if you're an entrepreneur today than it did 45 days ago, you know, because you can Zoom. I'll tell you where I am right now. I am in the middle of the woods in New Hampshire. This is like the best place to social isolate because I got 100 acres on that direction, no houses, 100 acres that way. There's nobody here except the only people we see are the Amazon delivery person like every day. And I can sit here and talk to you. I talk to Ireland. I talk to Scotland. I talk to France. I talk to Germany. You know, not just like one person, just like this, 100 people in those places. And here I am. I'm sitting in the middle of it. If you went that way, you would find 100 squirrels before you found one human being. And yet I can connect with everybody. So my point is that geography matters a lot less today than it did 45 days ago, which bodes, I think, well for a place like KAUST, right? Because you can connect with people. The norms, it's not just the technology. The habits, the social norms of doing this have changed.
We need a paper to be written on geography after the pandemic. And of geography, you've got Kevin asking you a question here.
Know a great school. Don't ask me to write a paper, Amal. I know a great university that has a huge endowment, and it's in the Middle East.
It's a joint co-authoring. That's a very good
idea. The leadership you have under a guy named Kevin Cullen, it's extraordinary. We look to you for that leadership.
So Kevin, asking you that question. Abdulrahman, read.
Exactly. You've got like a wonderful question, I think, that we might be ending on. So Kevin asking, what will an anti-fragile university look like at the end of the crisis?
Wow.
Yeah.
A lot different. How's that? I don't know, I should put it up on the chat, but it's entrepreneurship.mit.edu/speakers. You should all go to this entrepreneurship speaker series. And what we're going to be talking about is we must make anti-fragile individuals, right? That's a necessary but not sufficient condition. But anti-fragile individuals doesn't mean you have an anti-fragile team. So the key here is not just that anti-fragile individuals. That's necessary but not sufficient. We must have anti-fragile teams. Teams, you can have an anti-fragile team. That doesn't mean you have an anti-fragile organization. And then an organization doesn't mean you have an anti-fragile society. So what we're going to be doing in the last part of ours on this coming Thursday, which I'm really excited about, is we're going to be talking about a guy who's a Hall of Fame coach, John Calipari, who takes anti-fragile, like superheroes. He's a University of Kentucky basketball coach, Hall of Fame basketball. And he knows that to be a great basketball player, to be an anti-fragile, you have to have a big ego. And he takes them and he melds them into an anti-fragile team, an organization, that Kentucky basketball organization, that wins year after year, even though they get new people all the time. And then we're going to have Deval Patrick talk about an anti-fragile society. To me, the university has got to continue to teach management, but it's got to teach how do we create anti-fragile individuals, anti-fragile teams, anti-fragile organizations, and anti-fragile societies. and they have to practice that as well. So I think you're going to see it's going to be a lot more entrepreneurial, a lot more digital, and it's going to be, and when I say entrepreneurial, it's not just going to be the mindset, the skill set. It's going to be that community collaboration, and the principled aspects are going to be interwoven in that, and they must be. So with that, well, are we out of time? Yeah. You said that was the last
question. We are.
Can I just say,
we're mindful of your time.
Exactly.
Yes. Yes, the Amazon person could be here any minute now.
Yeah.
I just want to say,
please.
I just want to say is that, you know, I've been to Saudi Arabia many, many times. One of my really proud moments was working with my students, Omar Almadi, you know, and crew to get the book in Arabic, because that meant a lot to me, because there's so many people out there. And Saudi Arabia has a very young population. Saudi Arabia has a very, look at there, has a very young population. And they need to be innovation-driven entrepreneurs, not the historical trader entrepreneurs, but innovation-driven entrepreneurs. And so what you're doing at KAUST is incredibly important. And I could not, I wish I could be there and support you more, but you know, I've liked social distancing long before we needed to do it. but you've got great leadership. The two of you have the right idea. I think Kevin Cullen and Hatan are doing a great job, and your new head of KAUST. I can't tell you how important it is what you're doing. And I wish you guys the best, and I'm here to support you. You know, you always have a friend at MIT.
Bill, thank you so much. That was incredible. I promised one shout out, which was one of your students from attended your MIT bootcamp in Seoul, South Korea, Muhammad Razaz. And he's like, please, you know, ask him to host an upcoming bootcamp in Saudi. The region needs it. So I have fulfilled my end of the promise. To everybody, Bill is an amazing speaker. I'd encourage you to go to YouTube. He's got several of these long 1 hour deep dive lectures. One is on personal crisis and management. And, you know, it's talking about management and leadership, and there's a lot of insight there. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you.
Can I do one other thing that
yes.
We have an online community, Abdulrahman. It's at www.d-eship.com. Let me just put it in here. And
make sure to click all panelists and attendees when you're typing it in the chat.
I just sent it to all panelists. I'm sorry.
Okay. So, hold on. Oh.
We'll repost it.
And that's a place where people go and there's a forum and they post questions. And if you want to write an article that you think would help people, we're trying to build that community online to overcome this. And people think I go in there and I look at the forum and I try to answer questions. But what's even more exciting is other people answering the questions, because I am not, I don't have great wisdom. I mean, I just am older than all of you, and I've got a lot more experience. But when we build the community up, and let me put, this is my favorite background right here. When we build the community up, everyone helps each other. Each wolf needs to be strong, but it says the strength of the pack is the wolf. So each wolf needs to be strong, which makes us a strong community. But the strength of the wolf is in the pack. By that we mean is if each wolf is strong and does its job, then they're stronger inside the pack. And that's what we're trying to do, because if we can build the wolf pack, that's much stronger than any one individual. So I have now exceeded my time. Thank you all so much for having me.
We're definitely here, and everyone is excited. Everyone's sending shout outs. And there's someone who's mentioning if you can put another version of the disciplined entrepreneurship with Amina, you know, kind of eye, and Amina, you know, lens, where we can really focus on some of the startups in the region. So that could be an interesting thing to look at, to think about.
Yes. Again, a great project for KAUST.
Definitely in collaboration with you. I just want to tell you, I'm no longer at KAUST, but KAUST is at my heart, by the way. The Small and Medium Enterprise Authority, I'm running a global entrepreneurship network, but I always take pride in working with KAUST and with the team. And when I was trying to even set up this whole session with the team, you know, it's no better partner, really. You know, KAUST is always the source. And that's where I was to MIT in the first place, you know. So it's been really...
I mean, geography is less of a barrier and organizations collaborating more. I think, you know, we're taking the best out of this whole thing. Thank you so much, Bill. You know, it was long-term thinking. That was incredibly helpful, and not to just get fixated on the immediate red herring and immediate crisis. And I love...
Let me end with great entrepreneur who said, Biggie Smalls, who said, because I went from a negative to a positive. And with this crisis, it's a negative, but we're going to come out the other side and we're going to make that negative a positive. Thank you, everybody. Salaam alaikum.
Alaikum salam. So this is we're hoping this is the continuation of something consistent. So thank you guys for coming. We're going to be doing, this is a series, as you can see. So we're going to have multiple speakers with different perspectives. Stay tuned. We've got really exciting things planned for you. And thank you so much for your time and your questions.
Thank you so much. And the recording will be posted soon. A lot.
Exactly.
Thank you so much. You take care, guys.